We're going to start these proceedings. It's fantastic to see such a wonderful turnout. And I guess many of you may be aware that the turnout was so great. We did it last night too, and had just as many people. So our speaker today is a great draw. Perhaps we could have done this all week long, and it's going to be a wonderful evening. And this is sort of the kickoff of this New Year's or new academic year's series of math encounters, which has really been, I think the math museum people have done a great job at organizing these things. So, Museum of Mathematics, I should say. So our speaker today is Keith Devlin, whom you surely know. And I learned last night that he's from Yorkshire. See, we did this last night. Last night I rehearsed this introduction, so now I should be an expert at it. But still, I wrote these notes. So he's from Yorkshire, England, which is a perfectly respectable place to be from. And yeah, I got a laugh last night, too. That's good. And Keith was trained as a logician. We all should be logicians. Logic is good, but he's a mathematical logician, which perhaps most of you don't realize is actually a branch of mathematics, foundations it's called. And at some point, it occurred to some folks to dig more deeply into the basic definitions and axioms and what do we got here in mathematics. And a fellow you may have heard of, Bertrand Russell, was quite a contributor to this effort. And so it's trying to understand basic definitions. What are the integers? What is this? What is that? How do you get to the bottom of things? And it's a never-ending task, really. Mathematical logic is quite an interesting subject. And that was Keith's. He moved on, came to the U.S., obviously. He's at Stanford. He's on public radio. He's written a lot of books and really popularized mathematics in many, many wonderful ways. I, in anticipation of his introduction, I began reading one of his books called The Unfinished Game. And I strongly recommend this book. At least I strongly recommend the first 30 or 40 pages, which is where I am at this point. Well, you know, it's something. It gives you a taste of it. I know it's going to all be terrific. And this book is about gambling, which is something that I have always enjoyed. Sometimes with actually winning. But this is about two very famous mathematicians, Pascal and Fermat. Fermat of the famous Fermat's Last Theorem, and Pascal of, maybe you remember Pascal's triangle when you get one and then two twos and then one, two, one, and then, God, I get it all mixed up, but one, three, what is it, one, three, three, one, and so on, the successive binary squares of x plus y squared, the coefficients. Anyway, that was a nice triangle. It's called Pascal's triangle. Then they were trying to dope out probability theory. The basic questions of what are the odds of these dice falling in a certain way and one thing or another. People gambled and there were odds, there should have been odds. And it turned out it was what we think of as being very simple today. You know, obviously the probability of throwing a one in a die of six sides is 1/6, right? And doing it twice in a row is 1/6 times 1/6. But those questions were not so obvious. Those answers were not so obvious. How do you figure this out? And it took quite a while for smart guys like Pascal and Fermat to really formulate modern probability theory of this type. And what seemed simple was not so simple. The concepts were foreign, and they put it together. And the book is fascinating with letters and one thing or another from one to the other and going on about the beginnings of the subject. So I recommend the letter. I recommend the book. It's called The Unfinished Game. And you can go buy one. I don't even get a royalty or anything from that recommendation. So we're now going to hear Keith. He's going to talk about the Golden Triangle. And I know you're going to have a wonderful time. So we'll welcome Keith Devlin.
Thank you. So thank you, and welcome, everyone. And you're actually going to get two talks for the price of one. Well, the price was zero, so you're going to get two divided by zero. You're going to get infinite value, in fact. But you're actually going to get two talks. The first talk is a talk that I might well have given, and I actually think I did give 15 or 20 years ago. And then, having gained wisdom as I got older, I paused and said, was everything I used to give in my lectures about the golden ratio and the Fibonacci numbers, was it actually true? And that's the part of that's the focus of the second talk, the second half of this evening. So sit back and enjoy the first part, because some of what you hear will be true and some of it won't. I used to think it was all true. And if you believe everything you read on the web, you will be convinced it's true. And that's one of the meta lessons tonight, is that do not believe everything you find on a website, no matter how slick the website looks. Okay, so the first part is a sort of performance. I guess I always wanted to perform off Broadway, and tonight I guess is close to being off Broadway. So let's just run in. So this is the standard story that we hear time and again and that we can find in all sorts of books, magazine articles, newspaper references. You can hear occasionally, if you go through the archives, you'll hear me on NPR talking about it some years ago, saying something very similar to what I'm going to be saying now. So this is the standard story about the golden ratio, and it's a wonderful story. You know, this is a wonderful story. It would be wonderful if everything I'm about to tell you is true. It begins by saying that human beings have a preference for a rectangle, that there's a most aesthetically pleasing rectangle that humans respond to, that we resonate with. And the most perfect rectangle has various names. This is a drawing of one. It's all to do with the aspect ratio of the width to the height. It's sometimes called the golden rectangle. The ratio, the aspect ratio of the width to the height is sometimes called the golden ratio. And it's also known, that aspect ratio is known as the divine proportion. And you can mix the adjectives and the nouns. You can talk about the divine rectangle and so forth. But you know, you can see which way it's going. Gold, something that we have as value. Divine. You know, anything that can be called golden and divine, you know, that gets people's attention. So this is a number that clearly has certainly aroused the attention and the passions of people for a long time. There's another way of getting at it. Obviously, if there's something special about it, and it's a number and a ratio, then there should be a good mathematical reason for making it special. You know, it can't just be someone's favorite number. And here is a way of getting at it through mathematics. There'll be a diagram in a minute, but let me just simulate a diagram. It says you take a line and you divide it into two in such a way that the ratio of the entire line to the long segment equals the ratio of the long segment to the shorter segment. Okay, you got that? Here's the diagram. Let's use the units so that the length of the line is 1. And then if we divide the line at the point x, the longer piece has length x, and the shorter piece will have length 1 minus x. So the ratio of the long one of the whole piece to the longer length is 1 over x. The ratio of the longer length to the shorter length is x over 1 minus x. So there's an equation that captures that verbal description. Most people in the audience, if you're too young, you might not know how to solve it. If you're not so young, you might have forgotten how to solve it. But if you're in the middle, you should be able to cross multiply. Well, it depends where you learnt your mathematics. I was taught to cross multiply here. It's kind of a dangerous thing to say in some circles, but I would solve it by cross multiplying, and then I'd get a quadratic equation that looks like that, and then I would use the formula to solve it, and then you'd get a positive solution that's like that, and you work it out, it's 0.6183, and you get that thing down at the bottom. Okay, so you get 1.61803, and it turns out that this number is actually irrational. You cannot express it as a quotient of two whole numbers, and in fact the decimal expansion continues forever without settling into any kind of a pattern and so forth. It just keeps on producing different patterns of numbers, which is actually worth bearing in mind, because lots of things that people believe about the golden ratio are that it actually is the ratio of certain well-defined measurements of the body and so forth. Well, if it's an irrational number, that's rather hard to do. But just bear that at the back of our mind. It could well be true asymptotically, so we won't put too much faith into that. This is certainly a popular number. If we're talking about the popularity stakes, this is a big one. If you this was about 3 days ago, I did a Google search, and I got 4,410,000 results for the phrase golden ratio. That's a lot of hits. Okay, so this is a popular number. People have heard about it. If you're an educator in mathematics, you want to use this number, right? This gets people's attention. So this is it's irresistible to the educator, the math educators. If you start going to some of those websites, you'll find all sorts of wonderful claims. They stir your heart. These are great stories. You will learn that our ancestors, the Egyptians, when they were building the pyramids, used the golden ratio. And you'll see these diagrams with phis. I'll talk later about the use of the symbol phi for the golden ratio. You will read that the Parthenon, the Greeks designed the Parthenon based on this thing called the golden ratio. And you'll find diagrams that show how the golden ratio is related to the Parthenon. If you're near the front, you can read the bottom. It actually also says you'll find it in the cathedral at Notre Dame and various other places. So there's lots of references to it being used in aesthetically pleasing buildings. If you look at some of those websites in more detail, you'll see details of the diagrams. Okay, just there they are, golden ratio, Greek architecture, not only on the facades, but on the floor plan and so forth. So there's this commonly repeated belief that the Greeks, because they were believed in beautiful buildings, they embedded the golden ratio in their architectural designs. There's the one we looked at on that website, that it's in the pyramids. You'll also see that in the thousands of Babylonian tablets that have been discovered, there's discussions and there's references to the golden ratio. So the Babylonians were apparently aware of this, according to what you will read. You will read that in many buildings, modern buildings, the golden ratio has been embodied by the architects in the design of those buildings. Some local landmarks here. Another famous local landmark is the General Secretariat Building of the United Nations, which is also claimed to be a chocolate cake of three layers, each of which is a golden rectangle, stacked one on top of the other. Wonderful idea, right? Stirs the imagination. You will read, I'm from California, right? So what can I say? You know, we had a movie star for a governor for a period. You'll see that if you take the human body, you measure from the head to the floor, and you divide it by the measurement from the navel to the floor, then that apparently is the golden ratio. Okay, that's one of the things you'll read. You'll read that it's in art, in painting in particular. You'll read that in Botticelli's Venus, the golden ratio was part of the way that was structured. And you'll find website images like the one on the right, where you see along the side lots of stages where you get phi squared, you get all sorts of references to the golden ratio. Okay. You'll read that Leonardo da Vinci made use of the golden ratio in his self-portrait, in the Mona Lisa, in the diagram of a man, which was actually thought maybe to be the mathematician Luca Pacioli, who he knew, and in the Vitruvian Man. So there's lots of claims about da Vinci recognizing the beauty that's implicit in the golden ratio and making use of it in his undoubtedly beautiful paintings. You'll read very stirring descriptions in some of the literature about Georges Seurat in the parade of a circus building the whole thing out of golden rectangles, that it was totally golden rectangles on top of each other. And there's certainly rectangles everywhere. Okay. You'll read that the French architect Le Corbusier, the name he gave himself later in life, advocated and made use of the golden ratio. You will read that the Roman poet Virgil composed the Aeneid based on the golden ratio. You'll read that musicians also use the golden ratio in their compositions. Mozart, Bartok, using the golden ratio. Debussy, using the golden ratio. You will read that the Nautilus shell grows in a fashion governed by the golden ratio. You will read that the golden ratio is an incredibly ubiquitous constant in geometry. That if you're doing geometry, we know that in geometry pi comes up a lot. Pi is all over the place in geometry. Well, you will also read that the golden ratio is all over the place in geometry. In Penrose tilings, in the pentagon, in the pentagram, in the regular solids, in fractals. Golden ratio, it's there, it's everywhere. So the story goes. You will see that the golden ratio has some really interesting representations. As a fraction, an infinite fraction that you can form by iteratively taking the square root of something plus what comes next. And I mean, which is something you can program very easily into a calculator and run it. Or that it's this infinite so-called continued fraction that goes on and on and on later. We'll come back to these later. We'll come back to all of them later and we'll talk about them. But I'm giving you the lecture I would have given you 15 years ago. Okay. You'd even read that, that pi is in the Bible, that if you look at the Bible, you'll see references that tell you that the Ark of the Covenant is designed according to the dimensions of the golden ratio, and that so too is Noah's Ark. So you read a lot of stuff about the golden ratio. Okay. You'll also read about connections between the golden ratio and the Fibonacci sequence. So I want to tell you a little bit about the Fibonacci sequence. Okay, there's a very famous mathematician. He's famous now. It's an interesting story. In fact, I tell his interesting story in my most recent book, which is this one, The Man of Numbers, Fibonacci's Arithmetic Revolution. It's a very interesting story. By the way, there's going to be a quiz in a minute. This is a math lecture. There's a quiz. And the quiz that has two prizes. Well, it has one prize twice. The two best scores that we're going to give to this quiz will be autographed copies of the book, and at the end of the talk, the two people who have won them, I'll personalize them and autograph them to you. And he's an interesting guy. Let me just tell you a little bit about him. He was famous in his lifetime, very famous, largely because he wrote this book, Libra Bacci, which was the first comprehensive account of modern arithmetic using the 10 digits 0, 1 through 9, using the algorithms that we use today for adding, multiplying, subtracting, design. He wrote the first book on that in the Western world. That system was invented by Indian mathematicians in the first 6 or 7 centuries of the current era. Then the traders and the mathematicians in the Arabic-speaking world that were going up and down the Silk Route, trading goods between the Orient and Europe. They learned of this, they started using these methods, these arithmetic methods in their trading. The mathematicians started to extend those methods started to really develop what we now think of as modern algebra. And then Leonardo discovered that, or observed that, when he was a young teenager from Pisa, who went across to Bugia to join his father, who was a customs official. And that Leonardo recognized that this was a very powerful way of doing arithmetic, much more powerful than the ways that people had used, which were using a counting board where you moved pebbles around or by doing counting with the fingers. And Leonardo, who'd grown up in Pisa, which was then the center of world trade for the Europeans, because that's where the traders went out across the Mediterranean down to North Africa, and there were goods going up and down from the Orient to Europe. Having grown up in that environment, Leonardo recognizes he's powerful, goes back to Pisa in his early 20s, writes this book, Libra Bacci, and within 20 years, 30 years, you've got modern banking, insurance, accounting practices, large trading conglomerates going up. You've got the modern commercial world coming out of Pisa and Florence within the next half century, it started to grow. And it was always assumed that Leonardo's Libra Bacci started that revolution. That assumption was finally proved in 2003. And my book is a story about the discovery in 2003 that came through the discovery of a manuscript in a library in Florence, which I had the pleasure to hold in my hand about a month ago. Awesome when you hold a manuscript in your hand that probably created the modern Western world. It's in a library in Florence. Forget the cathedral. 100 meters north of the cathedral, there's a piece of parchment that's the beginning of the modern world. When I came out of that museum, I didn't even notice the cathedral. Well, I've seen the cathedral before. So I was kind of used to the cathedral. And I'd been going to Italy every day, every year for 10 years, largely to write the book, but also because I like Italian food, I like Italian wine, I love the Tuscan countryside, and I ride a bicycle. Italy's heaven to me. So I digress. Actually, I don't digress. I'm getting into the story. Okay. This was a very complicated book. This was a book about how to run your own business. It was a commercial arithmetic book. It tells you how to divide profits, how to calculate interest rates. No, it didn't tell you that. I'm wrong. Interest rates was somewhere else. How to divide the profits. It tells you how to trade goods and measurements, how to deal with volumes and weights of things, how to convert currencies, which was important even within Italy because there were dozens and dozens of different currencies, how to do alloying of metals because you had to tell how accurate the coins were and so forth. So it was a very practical book filled with hundreds and hundreds of examples. It is undoubtedly the world's most important and most boring book. No doubt about it. Okay. Actually, that's a little bit unfair. It's sort of boring if you think of it just as, why does he keep giving these many examples? But if you actually go into and get back into what he was doing and realize that he was doing this in the 13th century, then you realize it actually isn't a boring book. It's a fascinating book. But superficially, it looks boring. And he sort of knew that because he would spice up the account every now and then with a cutesy little problem, a little fun problem. One of them was a problem about a rabbit population. On the left, there is the first page, the first content page of the 13th century manuscript, a 13th century manuscript copy of Libra Bacci. It's not in his handwriting. Actually, we don't know that. We don't think that's in his handwriting. And it almost certainly wasn't because it would have been, we think this was pretty sure this was written after he died. So it's a copy, but very close to his lifetime. And this is a copy that's in the public library in Siena. And since it's in the public library, you can't borrow it. It's in the reserved section. But it is the public library. That means that in principle, you can walk in and look at it. And I did a few years ago. All I had to show was, well, I had to show my passport. And I had to show my Stanford ID card. So if you possess a Stanford ID card, they'll let you look at it. I suspect if you possess a Harvard card or a Yale card, I mean, you'd probably get in. It will be an interesting experiment, those of you with SUNY cards, to know whether you can get in. Okay, interesting experiment. You, depending on how confident you are in the reputation of the City University of New York, is whether you want to perform that experiment. Because I have now challenged you and said, Stanford card gets you in. Okay, be that as it may. Here's this problem. That was just to give you time to read the problem. It's about how fast this rabbit population grows. And it was just to give a practice in dealing with Hindu-Arabic arithmetic. It's a wonderful one because it's a nice cutesy problem that gets you to do a lot of adding of two numbers. This is just dressing addition into a... I mean, nowadays, he'd release a video game for the iPhone, but that was ahead of his time. Okay. If you simply, you don't have to do anything sophisticated, you can just work it out by the rule. This population has two rabbits, first of all. It takes them a 1 month in order to reach maturity, and then they have children. The next month they have more children, but the children have to wait a month before they have children. And so you've got this lag each time, the new ones have to wait 1 month, and it grows that way. Okay. And so you can count the pairs. There's one, then there's two pairs, then there's three, then there's five. If you go on a little bit further than that, it gets tedious drawing the little rabbits. So let's just replace them by points. And here's a computer-generated image that takes you 8, 13, 21, 34, 55, and you can keep going. But at this point, you would want to find a simplifying formula. You wouldn't want to just keep on going through that process. And if you do find a simplifying formula, and I'll give it to you in a minute, if it hasn't become already obvious, the numbers continue in this way. And then by going out to the end of the year, you can figure out, you can answer the question, how many rabbit pairs are there at the end of the year? Okay, so there's the sequence up to as far as 89. The rule that generates this is this. You simply take the last two numbers in the sequence so far, add them together, that gives you the new one. So you start with 1 and 1, you have 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, 5 plus 8 is 13, and on and on and on. Very simple rule, you just keep applying the rule. Okay. Those are the Fibonacci numbers. That is the Fibonacci sequence generated just by adding together to give the new one. Adding the last two give you the new one. What does this have to do with the golden ratio? Well, if you take the Fibonacci numbers, and this was observed many centuries ago, and you start to divide one by the other, that each one by the one previous to it, 2 divided by the 1 before it is 2 divided by 1, which is 2. 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. 5 divided by 3 is 1.6 recurring. 8 divided by 5 is 1.6, and so on. So those numbers rapidly start to look like the golden ratio. And that is not so. The next thing I'm going to say is a fact. Okay, this is a mathematically verifiable fact. This is not a is it true or is it false thing. That really does. The further out you go, that gets arbitrarily close to the golden ratio. That has also been known for a long time. So this Fibonacci sequence is closely related to the golden ratio. I should perhaps mention that the Fibonacci sequence was known centuries before Leonardo was born. It was known to the Indian mathematicians. In all the early writings, or many of the early writings of arithmetic that came up from the Indians and then through the Arabic-speaking world, this was an example, not always in terms of rabbits, sometimes in terms of pigeons and various other things, but it was a standard example. Okay. It was known. So Fibonacci didn't invent it. Actually, Fibonacci didn't really invent anything in Liber Abaci. He was a great mathematician, and he wrote other books where he did a lot of original stuff. And some of the answers he gives in Liber Abaci might be his, but the methods he described were hundreds of years old. This was an old example, one of hundreds. It was called the Fibonacci sequence only in the 19th century by a historian who wanted to give it a cute name. So it got its name hundreds of years after he was dead. He didn't invent it, and he just put it in an example. So, you know, he's been kind of lucky that we call that the Fibonacci sequence, because he had almost nothing to do with it. Okay. But that has been his legacy. One of my main reasons for writing this book, by the way, was to tell the true story of Fibonacci. You know, if all we know about Fibonacci, it's like, you know, if all we knew about Fibonacci was that he had this sequence, we don't know really anything about him because it wasn't his. But the guy was a great human being that had a lot to do with modern civilization. And my book, I hope, will sort of rectify that absence of knowledge. Incidentally, the reason nobody knew about him for hundreds of years, he was rediscovered in the 1870s, essentially, and his great works were sort of gradually uncovered during the 19th and 20th century. The reason history forgot him was a classic case of technology overriding him. He wrote one of the last great handwritten manuscripts, and then the printing press comes along, and all the old handwritten manuscripts are just left to gather dust in the monasteries, and nobody looks at them again, and everyone's into print. And, you know, it's the equivalent of Borders books closing, right? You know, the next generation of kids will think Borders was just this historic thing. Well, that happened to Leonardo. He basically was driven out of business. His books were driven out of business by the printing press. Okay, so the question is, of all of that thing, that was my lecture from many years ago, how much of that is true and how much of that is false? So here's the first part of audience participation. So we're going to put the lights up. And on your chair when you came in, there was a quiz. This is a chance to win one of two copies of this book. If you want to stand a chance of winning, don't forget to write your name on the top. Because when you've filled in the quiz, the volunteers are going to come round and collect the quiz. Then as I'm speaking, for the rest of the talk, they will grade the quiz. If there are two unique winners, they will win the book. If there's a tie at the top, we're going to use random selection. So we may have to pull winners out of a hat among those with the highest score. Okay. So we'll use the fair method of random selection if we need to. Some of these you will know the answers. Some you will probably have to make a wild guess, because I've included some questions that are not so well repeated on the websites. There's nothing more at stake than whether you win those books or not. So relax, okay? All you type A personalities, it doesn't really matter if you don't win, right? It's all about taking part and having fun. So just enjoy it, have fun, and just say what you think is true and what is false. Okay. We're going to be using the pine cones. Pine cones are going to be coming up too, yes. Please don't eat the pine cones. They are not snacks. But we will be using the pine cones. We'll also be using the tape measures. Everything you've been given will be used. I will point out the first sentence, by the way. We have to be careful what we mean by false. The rest of my talk, I'm going to adopt a scientific approach, which means we don't accept anything as true unless we have strong grounds for doing it, either a proof or strong empirical evidence. There has to be evidence to accept it. So false essentially means unproven. That's the sort of scientific notion. Doesn't mean to say it's proved false. It means there is a complete absence of anything in support of it. So false is unproven. Okay. That's the sort of science. That is the scientific approach, the rational approach. I'm not going to go there in this talk. How do we respond to respect it? It means I respect it. This is my quiz. I also get to say which is right and which is wrong. There's no arguing with the editors, the final. I'm the arbitrator of what is correct. I will say that it's not just my opinion. At the end of the talk, I'm going to give you a reference to all of the facts I'm about to give you about truth and falsity. That reference is correct in everything except one example, and I'll point that one out. So I'm going to give you the reference that you can double check. That is my rule book, as it were, of what's true and false. And I'll give you that at the end. There's a single reference, a book you can get, where everything I'm going to talk about can be found. It's not a book by me, so that makes two mathematicians that you've got providing authority to these decisions. We'll come into that. We have tape measures, we can figure it out. Yes. So I'm going to start edging people along. I'm going to do the school teacher thing and say, "Now, come on now, don't take too long." So at this point, the volunteers should start walking up and down menacingly and glowering at people if you think they're taking too long. What we should do is pass the results down to the ends of the aisles, and then people will come down and collect them. Okay, so let's have volunteers walking up and down, and look menacing. Get these people to give their answers in. And don't forget to put your name on the top. Okay, are we getting close to getting them all in now? Okay. Okay, time is almost up. We need to get them all in and move ahead. I will mention that we did this last night, and we had two people tied with the highest score. Nobody got them all right last night. Okay. And one of the people who tied with the highest score was a professional mathematician. So but, you know, I put some questions in that unless you went into the literature and looked them up, you wouldn't have known. I didn't want to make it too easy to get them all right. But if they're all in, then we'll move ahead. Because during the second part of the talk, this is the scientific talk, where I examine the evidence and see what we know and what we don't, you'll see the answer to most of these things. So if we can have the lights back down, Okay. We'll move ahead and all will be revealed. Okay, there's at least one more script over there. You coming on that one? Okay. If you still have a script, just wave it in the air and someone will collect it. And then these great volunteers are going to go to the side and grade these things. So, the world's most perfect rectangle, okay, is there a world's most perfect rectangle? Is there a rectangle that human beings prefer to all others, that they find the most pleasing? Well, you won't need the lights up for this one, and we'll keep looking at this, but on another thing you've been given is a little sheet like this. This is not a hand-in quiz. I just would like you, for your own benefit, to put a cross in the rectangle that you find the most pleasing. Not whether you think it's the golden ratio, the golden rectangle, the one that you find most pleasing. If you don't have a preference, leave it blank. Okay? It's okay not to have a preference. And I will do a show of hands in a minute to see which one's worked out. This is really an experiment to see empirically if human beings actually do have a preferred rectangle. So, which one do you like most? Okay. Well, it shouldn't take long, this one. If you like it most, it should just be, bang, there you are. You put a cross in it. Okay. It's actually false, as we're about to see. There is no preferred rectangle. Okay. Here's the thing you've been given. Let me show you the one and only golden rectangle in there. It's that one. How many people got that one? Look around, everybody. Not many hands have gone up. This is not the preferred rectangle. How many people got the one on the top left? Anybody on the top left? Top left. How many got the second one along on the top? Hands are going up. How many people got the third one along? Hands are going up. How many got the fourth one along? Hands are going up. I don't need to go on with the rows. In that diagram, there's going to be people in the room who think it's a preferred rectangle. We're different. We're varied. We have different preferences. Moreover, if I'd given you these in a different arrangement, you might well have picked a different one. What the order in which they appear, the circumstances they appear, the color, the background, the texture, time of day, all sorts of things influence people's choices. In fact, this is one of these standard experiments that you get in second year psychology class at university, where you run these experiments, and by manipulating the way you present them and the colors and the backgrounds, you can get people with answers all over the place. There is absolutely no preferred rectangle, and it was interesting that the famous golden rectangle had fewer hands go up than many of the others. Okay, so the golden ratio cannot be the aspect ratio of the most aesthetically pleasing rectangle for the blatant reason that there is no most aesthetically pleasing rectangle. So that one has gone, that cherished belief. And remember, we're about to go into fine art, and we've already lost the fact that there's the most aesthetically pleasing reason. Now, we were told that the Greeks designed the Parthenon because it had the most pleasing dimensions. Okay. But there is no most pleasing dimensions. So this one looks extremely suspicious. And indeed, it's false. Isn't that a shame? Isn't that a shame? This is, you know, life, if you're a scientist, life is just tough at times. You have to believe the evidence. There is global warming. We might not like it, especially if we live in an oil-producing state, but there is global warming. We should accept the fact. That's what the evidence is. It's just happening. So the question is, what about these diagrams? Well, just think about it for a minute. The Parthenon is actually a very big building. That is not the Parthenon. That is a very small picture of the Parthenon. On that very small picture, some very thick lines have been drawn. Scale that up to the Parthenon and imagine how wide those lines are. They're huge. If I'm allowed to draw lines that are several feet wide on buildings, I can get any rectangle I like in there. I mean, I can cover this room with golden rectangles if I can draw really thick lines. So, yeah, if you take a small photograph and you cover it with thick lines, you can find... And it's even worse than that. Why, in drawing the rectangle on the top right, didn't they go out as far as the plinth? Well, because if they did, you wouldn't have got the golden ratio. This is wishful thinking put into a diagram. This is rigging the diagram and faking things to support a belief. But that's not what science is about. I mean, it's a nice belief, but this is Santa Claus stuff. It's great to believe it, but, you know. Okay. What do we know about it? So we've lost an awful lot of stuff about the Greeks. I mean, we've lost most of the fun stuff, if you like. Well, certainly, the Greeks knew this number. It was in Euclid's Elements. Incidentally, the Parthenon was finished about 150 years before Euclid was born. So if the golden ratio was not even known until Euclid's Elements, then there's another reason why it wasn't in the Parthenon. But they may have known about it. Euclid just collected a lot of material. But certainly the first written reference we've got to it, explicit reference, is this one in Euclid's Elements. And he gave us that definition that I give about splitting the line into two by the long and the short segments. That's all in Euclid's Elements. Now, Euclid, it is said of mathematicians that we're not very good at marketing and we tend to be a little bit boring. And it's true that Euclid didn't call it the golden ratio and he didn't call it the divine ratio. He called it extreme and mean ratio. He was scientifically honest. That's what it's about, he said. It's not the world's most catchy name, but it was an honest name. You know, full marks to Euclid for his honesty and his transparency, and zero marks for his marketing savvy. Okay. On the other hand, his book is still in print thousands of years after it was written, which is not bad going. Sadly, it was before copyright, and there's no estate to take in the money. You know, it's essentially a freebie, unless you buy it from Dover and you have to pay a small price. Okay, the name Divine Proportion, that actually came up in the work of Luca Pacioli, who was a contemporary of Leonardo da Vinci, a very famous mathematician, arguably the next really famous mathematician after Leonardo, and certainly the first person who wrote a big book after Leonardo's. And he also wrote a book called The Divine Proportion, a three-volume book, and gave it that name. Now, remember that there are all sorts of claims about Leonardo da Vinci using the golden ratio in his art. That story's going to get interesting because he was a close friend of Pacioli and Pacioli wrote this book. And moreover, Leonardo did some of the drawings in Pacioli's book. So Leonardo did know about the golden ratio. The question is going to be, did he use that knowledge in anything he did? That's going to be an interesting one to look at. So you can hold that one out there as maybe that one's still true. Okay, maybe it is. We'll see. Calling it golden, that's even more recent. Okay, that's sort of early to middle 19th century, a book written by Martin Ohm, in which he called it golden. The symbol phi, by the way, was introduced in about 1930 by an American mathematician as the symbol for the golden ratio. It used to be called tau, if it was called anything, but the phi is an American invention. Those are facts. I mean, that's that much we know. Okay, that's in the literature. Let's go on to that story, to the rest of the story. Can the golden ratio be found? Well, yeah, we can find it in the pyramids, but these are even bigger than the Parthenon. So if our technique is to take photographs and impose things on them, that is not going to be very convincing. And indeed, there's nothing more to it than that. You can draw them, but there's the one other thing you could do, you know, these guys left writings behind. You could go through all of their writings and say, okay, is there any reference that anything they've left behind that suggests that they knew, or even hints that they were using the golden ratio? And the answer is no. There's no evidence whatsoever that they even knew about the thing. That one's gone. Same for the Babylonians. In all of those stone tablets, no reference whatsoever to the golden ratio. Now, it may be that the golden ratio is, as I alleged, an important constant in geometry, and the Babylonians and the Egyptians certainly knew geometry, so implicitly they may have used the golden ratio. But we're looking for evidence that they actually knew about it and made use of it, and there's none whatsoever. Okay, false. Boy, are these things going down quickly. It's not easy being a mathematician, believe me. Life is full of disappointments if you're a mathematician. Why do we do it? Because the price of success after all those disappointments is like nothing else on the planet. It's like climbing a mountain. It's painful and it's hard, but boy, it feels good when you get to the top. Okay, here's an interesting one. Modern architects, we are told, use the golden ratio. Who tells us that? Modern architects tell us that. I was a college dean for a few years, and then I repented and recovered, and you know, I've been off the wagon now for a long time. So I was a dean for a period, and I was successful. I managed to raise $30 million from a donor, and we put up a science building. And we interviewed lots of architectural firms to decide, because this was a liberal arts college I was at. It was St. Mary's College of California, just outside of Berkeley. And we were into the liberal arts, we were into the great books. It was one of the great books colleges. And so we wanted to have architects who respected academic tradition, and so we put them through lots of interviews. And I was already working on my suspicions about the golden ratio, by the way. So I asked every one of these architectural firms, have you heard of the golden ratio? They all said, yes. I said, where did you learn? Oh, we learned about that at architecture school. When we're learning to be architects, when we're studying architecture, we're taught that as part of aesthetics and so forth. Yeah, we have that as part of our training. And so I then said, do architects use the golden ratio? Every architect said, yes. And then I asked them one more question. I said, have you ever used the golden ratio? And they all said, no. Now, figure that for a minute. Everybody thinks everybody's using it, but nobody is using it. That's what they call an urban myth. Nobody has ever seen that thing, but everybody knows everybody else has seen it. Classic human psychology, they don't use it. Everyone thinks people use it, but they actually don't use it. Okay, so, and if you look at all of the drawings, I should just mention that this was kind of interesting because these people wanted the contract. You know, we had $30 million to spend. They wanted that contract. So they were clearly trying to give us the answer. And they knew I was the dean and I was a mathematician. And some of them actually came in with presentations about we'll design the building according to the golden ratio. This was to be their first time of doing it. So they were clearly savvy enough about this. It is the case, actually, that some liberal arts colleges, including St. Mary's College of California, incidentally, where I was, do have buildings built on the golden ratio. And they did it explicitly because they wanted a mathematical theme in the buildings. That's a different matter from there being aesthetic reasons to do with the human brain. They explicitly said, we'll put the golden ratio in. That's true of, there are campuses like that, many of them. Okay, but that's a sort of an artifactual thing. Okay, but is it the case that buildings are typically put, you know, is it what they believe that it's part of the aesthetics? And the answer is no. Go through all of the design documents and everything, you won't see references to the golden ratio. You will often see references to 8x5, which is 1.6, which is sort of close to this irrational number, but close isn't, that's not good enough. 8x5 is actually a more natural thing than 1.618, blah, 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 blah. Okay, in terms of measuring and things. Okay, likewise, this is an interesting one because the only possible reason for drawing those lines the way they are is to get the golden ratio out of them. Totally hard. Not only have you got thick lines on a shrunken diagram of a picture, but they're obviously just drawn so that they have the golden ratio, and you just move them around until you get the piece of architecture that matches. So it's not very convincing, folks. Okay. What about this one? That would have been nice, but it's false. No evidence whatsoever that that's in there. There's a Disney film made many years ago that repeats this one, but it also repeats the thing about lemmings going over the cliff. So you've got to be careful what you read and what you see on TV and things. Okay, what about this one? Well, we can all argue that human bodies vary quite tremendously. Very few of us have bodies that look like Arnold Schwarzenegger then or now. And the navel is actually quite big on most of us, so that gives us a lot of scope about where to start measuring. And we're talking about getting very close to an irrational number. Bogus. Boo. focus. Yeah, it's going to be close to 1.6, but lots of things are close to 1.6. 8.8 over 5 is close to 1.6. 8 over 5 is very close to 1.6. Okay, gone. Okay, as is Arnold, right? So, well, actually, I guess we're going to see him on the screen again. Yeah. I have to admit, I was sad to discover that there was no evidence behind that whatsoever. Pity, there we are. This was the intriguing one, because we know lots about Leonardo. He was very interested in technology. He was a friend of Luca Pacioli. He knew the science. He knew the mathematics. He wrote all about stuff. So we have to say, given that Leonardo wrote about everything he knew and everything he did, if he used the golden ratio, he would have told us. And he didn't. No evidence whatsoever. And he would have told us, because he gives it with all these diagrams and drawings. He catalogued everything. No golden ratio. Sorry. And the other stuff about art. Here's a one you often see about the Last Supper. Again, there's only one reason for putting the drawing. This is slightly different, because the paintings are smaller. And admittedly, the lines are thick, but it's not quite as ridiculous as when you shrink a photograph of the Parthenon. So there's a little bit tight. This is a little bit of a tighter one. But the question here is, why do you put the rectangles where they are? And the answer is because you want to get golden rectangles. So, no, we've learnt too much now. We're not going to go for that one. Here's another one that and you can pull these off the web, and you can even find some of them in books. You know, ask yourself why the corners of the rectangles are there. What's so special about that little boy's forehead? What's wrong with the tip of his nose or his ear? You know, or something else. So, or his elbow, it looks like. It looks as though his right elbow is significant. You know what I mean? Or a rather strange part of that boat. I mean, why not the tip of the sail? Well, because what you're doing is taking golden rectangles and moving them around until they touch points. And if you make the lines thick enough, you've got enough wiggle room to fit them in. Okay. Unless you could show that the artist began with a sketch based on the golden ratio. This is bogus after it's wishful thinking. Exemplified in a diagram. No. Science is better than this, right? Okay, what about this one? This is supposed to be the example of a diagram that's built up on golden rectangles, and it's false. There's no evidence whatsoever. Remember, false means no reason whatsoever to support it. So from a scientific perspective, we take it as false. I mentioned before that some architects did put the golden ratios into buildings, particularly on liberal arts colleges. I'm going to make a confession moment in a moment about the Nautilus show. Okay. Some painters got interested in this. There's lots written about the golden ratio, and some painters do what painters do. They explore human ideas. And there were several painters, specifically in the early 20th century, that did incorporate the golden ratio explicitly, just as an experiment. You know, see what it looks like. Build it in. I mean, the cubists did all sorts of things with geometry. And it was interesting stuff. They even at one point, the cubists that is, organized an exhibition called the Golden Section, though none of the exhibits actually had anything that was claimed or did involve the golden ratio. They just thought it was a really cool name. You know, you can buy, actually a few years ago, you could buy Fibonacci jeans, if I remember right. You know, it was a cool name. It was hard to imagine how a pair of jeans embodied the Fibonacci sequence, but they were there. What about this one? We've talked about architecture. Le Corbusier, did he in fact advocate and use it? Actually, he was one of the people who did. There is a true one, okay? I mean, I didn't want you to be able to just put false in all the quizzes and get the best answer. So there are some true ones in there. It actually is hard to find any true ones, so there are a lot of false ones. But I will tell you that the quiz, a better than random strategy is to mark false for everything. Which is a reflection on how gullible we all are when it comes to believing stuff we'd like to believe. This is actually true. Not only in his architecture, he designed cities based on the golden ratio buildings, and even looked at the human body as being built up on golden ratios. But think for a minute, have you ever seen a human being whose body looks like that? If you saw the Cameron movie Avatar, that looks like the avatar in the movie. And when we saw the movie, we all thought, well, my sister is thin, but she's not that thin, right? So And look at the strange positioning of the navel, which seems put there only for the reason to give you the golden ratio. So this is transparent wishful thinking, and boy, do you have to stretch the body to get all those golden ratios in. So, yeah, he believed it, he used it, but this is just his way of conceptualizing it in something that's really unsustainable. Okay, what about the poetry one? Now, poetry is based on sort of nice meters and so forth, so one might expect that the golden ratio was in there. Maybe that's why these things resonate so nicely, but there's no reason to believe that. No evidence. What about the music? Same thing, you know, music has pattern. Maybe the golden ratio reflects in these things. Well, it turns out there's no evidence whatsoever that either of them even knew about the number, let alone used it. What about Debussy? We don't know. He knew people who knew about the golden ratio, he knew mathematicians. There's nothing concrete, but we've got to be careful. There is some reason to suspect he might have done. He didn't leave anything explicit, but there's reason to be doubtful about this one. So in grading the quiz, if you said true, you're okay. If you said false, you're okay. If you've put true and false, you're actually okay, although that's actually paradoxical and inconsistent. Or if you didn't put anything, you're okay. We're going to ignore that question, in other words, because we're scientists and we actually don't know. It's okay to admit you don't know. And if there's some reason to think it might be, well, let's be honest about it. So this is a don't know. Yeah, you see, there's lots of claims made. There are lots of claims made. Yep. Okay, how about this one? Now, you remember that science building I told you about that we spent $30 million? It wasn't my $30 million, it was somebody else's, but we spent that money. But this was a science building. The college where I was at, St. Mary's College, is where the person was a professor who created a thing called the Fibonacci Quarterly, a magazine. One of the answers, by the way, is that there is a respectable mathematical journal about the Fibonacci sequence. It's called the Fibonacci Quarterly, and it was created in, I think, 1963 by a professor of mathematics at St. Mary's College. The building is now named after him, Brother Alfred Brousseau. And so knowing that tradition and knowing that we were big in the liberal arts and so forth and the great books, we wanted to embed the golden ratio in that building. We wanted to inscribe it in stone. So in the main foyer, which was circular, we had a Nautilus shell that turned into the spiral staircase that went up to the other two floors. It was beautiful. There it was, the golden ratio. As you swept you in and up the stairs you went, we enshrined this wonderful thing, this wonderful mathematical architect, in stone. Literally, it was colored concrete. They can do fancy things with concrete. They mix them with colors and they polish them and it makes it look like marble, but it lasts longer. And so you get this wonderful multi. It's absolutely beautiful. My heart broke when I discovered that. The one reference I'm going to give you at the end to the source of truth or false of all these things that you can look up for yourself gets this one wrong. He thinks it is the golden ratio in there. Not quite. What you have is what's known as a logarithmic spiral. It's an equiangular spiral. The question is, what's the angle? Is it the angle that would be the golden ratio in radians, in the proportion of the circle, or is it some other angle? Well, it turns out it's some other angle. It is a logarithmic spiral. And to the human eye, one logarithmic spiral looks pretty much the same as the other. But you can measure the actual angle. And for the Nautilus shell, it is not, repeat, it is not the spiral that you get from the Fibonacci sequence by drawing rectangles and that kind of thing, or golden rectangles and all of this standard stuff. It's a different spiral. What a shame. Yeah. Okay, what a shame. But the lecture has a happy ending, believe me. I'm leaving the good stuff to the end. You are going to go away thinking the golden ratio is the coolest number on the planet, and it is. Which makes you wonder why we have to believe all of this nonsense, because it's absolutely wonderful. And we're going to get to the fun stuff in a minute. This is where the fun stuff begins. Is it in the Penrose tilings? Is it in the Pentagon? Is it in the pentagram? Is it in regular solids? Is it in fractals? You bet it is. It's everywhere. This is a great number. Mathematics loves this number. If you love mathematics, you've got to love this number. We get it. The artists don't, the musicians don't, the architects don't. We get this one. This is ours. And it's wonderful. Okay. Take a pentagon and start dividing. Now, remember, these phi is irrational, but this is, these are diagonals. So there's going to be Pythagoras' theorem. We're going to get irrationals floating around in these lengths. But if you start dividing long and short diagonals of a pentagon like this and keep going, you're going to get golden ratios. You can ad infinitum. You're just going to keep generating golden ratios. Golden ratio is going to keep coming back and hitting you in the face, bang, 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 when you start dividing things up this way. That one's correct. That one's correct. And if it's true for the pentagon, it's true for the pentagram, which is just putting a star inside one of these things. So it's definitely there. And of course, if it's true in the pentagram, then that brings us into all of this mysticism and ancient religions and, you know, New Age stuff. And so the golden ratio is certainly in there in the gold in the New Age. I mean, it's all up and down the Big Sur coast for those people who come out to California. Okay. In the bookstores, not necessarily in the... Penrose tilings, these are these interesting tilings that Roger Penrose came across that will tile the floor but without being in a repeating pattern. And he did that by building these double shapes called kites and darts, where the ratio is in fact the golden ratio. It was crucial to use the golden ratio to get this to work out. Okay. Fractals is extremely interesting. And this is about rules of growth. One way to build a fractal, a simple fractal, is a sort of plant. This is a sort of plant fractal. You start with from my angle, I can't see the red dot when I go onto the screen, but it's sort of, look at the one on the top left. You have a stem. And we're going to define a simple growth rule that says you take a stem and you put two smaller copies, two leaves of the stem, two descendants. The ratio of the two small ones to the big one is a fixed number. We won't say what it is. It can be anything you want when you start. But the two children are a fixed fraction of the length of the big one. Then you do the same to the two children. You put two little ones there, the same fixed fraction, and you keep repeating it. Now, one of three things can happen. If the fractional size of the small ones to the big one, if it's a small fraction, you know, like a tenth or something, then after a few branches, the little things are going to get so small, you're not going to see them. It's just going to look like a tree without many branches. Bum, 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 and it's going to look bare. It's going to look like a tree, you know, at the end of the season, when the arborist has been round and trimmed all the loose stuff off, and you're just going to be left with the big ones. If the ratio is too big, then after a few iterations, the various growths are going to cross over each. It's going to look a mess. It's just going to get all the leaves are going to cross over, and you're going to get a mess. The interesting case is in the middle, where as you grow out, the branches just begin to approach each other, but never quite touch. You can always squeeze in a new one, and you're going to get a beautiful lacy-looking effect. That's the number that does it. Boy, is this a special number. Wow, let's think of that. They're true. In fact, these are an exercise for the young children in the audience. Remember that formula, x squared equals x plus 1? If you play around with that, you'll get these things. It's just a very dramatic representation of x squared equals x plus 1. Again. So this is something that you can sort of figure out for yourself. Kind of cute. That's true. Okay, so we're into the true stuff now. Okay, well, given what we've just learned, George Clooney is good looking. So is Paula Zahn. They don't need the golden ratio. They're movie stars, right? I mean, of course it's. Do you remember when the hurricane was coming in a week or so ago and the newspapers had this satellite image, the Fibonacci, whatever it was? They all sort of said it's. No, it wasn't. It's a spiral. Of course it's a spiral. That's what they do. They go around like that. That's physics. I mean, that's physics too. You know, you do that with your hair and you've got the right hair, you're going to get whoosh. Nothing to do with a golden ratio. It's a spiral. Yeah. One spiral looks much like the other. I couldn't tell whether that's the golden one or not. Who knows? Do Pepsi sell more because their bottles are designed according to the golden ratio? I don't think so. You may have a dentist who will try to make your teeth golden rectangles, but I don't. And I've got to that stage in my life where my hearing is not quite what it used to be, but I don't think it's because my ears are not in the form of a golden spiral. Really weird stuff, right? But the websites are full of this. The sad thing is that lots of, is it so sad? I was going to say the sad thing is that lots of, when students at school do these projects, they get stuff on the web and they come back and their projects are littered with stuff that's actually false. It's only bad if you don't go on eventually to sort of say, well, let's just check whether these things are true. You know, my view is this kind of stuff did hook me on mathematics. It was part of the pastiche that made me interested in mathematics. Partly why I think I found it difficult to lose these things. But, you know, I grew up, I became an adult, and I had to throw away childish things and things that were just beliefs, you know, like fairies and things like that. Well, I guess maybe some people in the room believe in fairies, but, you know, I just had to give those things up, and it's just part of growing up. I still find fairies are cute things to believe in, and they're nice to have in movies and things, and great stories about them. You know, I read my children fairy stories, but, you know, that's fairy stories. You know, mathematics is not fairy stories. It's actually much better than most fairy stories. Okay, what about the Fibonacci sequence? Well, we all saw how it was connected. I'll tell you what, before we do that, before I move ahead to that one, let's do something else hands-on. Remember Arnold Schwarzenegger and the dimensions of the human body. Okay, we can have the lights up for a moment now. And this is the moment for the people to come around with the moving cameras. Because what I want you to do, and to every two desks, or to every two chairs, you'll have a little tape measure. Okay, so you should, if you don't know the person next to you, you're about to get to know quite a bit about them. Because I want you to look for pairs of measurements. This is a family evening, be very careful. I want you to look at pairs of measurements of human body and see what you can find where the ratio of one measurement to the other is about 1.62, the golden ratio. There's no prizes, but if you can come up with a really unusual measurement, it would be cute. So just take a couple of minutes seeing if you can find the ratio. Okay, I'm going to start to draw some order now. It's been... I'll tell you, if you were sitting where I was sitting, this has been very interesting to watch. Okay. How many people came up with a pair of measurements that were about 1.62? Okay. A few people. I was expecting slightly more. I would expect that by now... Well, first of all, it must be obvious that if you play around long enough, you're going to find some examples, because you can vary things quite a lot. It's not going to take long to find golden ratios. If anybody came up with a pair of measurements that give you the golden ratio when you divide one by the other that was really unusual, and you want to come up to the mic and tell us what pair, it would be good to have some new examples. So if you think you've got an example that's novel of a pair of measurements... I mean, you know, other than the sort of navels and things, and I didn't see anyone measuring navels, which is nice to say. If you've got an interesting example, come up to the mic either now or at the end and let us know, because it would be just nice to know some different examples. But the purpose was to just indicate that once you start measuring things, there are so many different things you can measure, and you can make things a bit bigger and a bit smaller, that it doesn't take... I didn't give you really long enough, but, you know... I thought we'd gone on long enough, quite frankly. If you measure long enough, then you can find something close to the golden ratio. Okay, so that doesn't tell you anything except that people are ingenious and there's lots of things you can measure on the human body. Okay, let's go back and we'll take the lights back down, please. We'll go now to Fibonacci numbers, which we know are connected to the golden ratio. That part was true. That really is connected. Okay. One of the things you'll read about, and we didn't see these earlier, these I'm just going to give you the answers as we go through. And there we go, yeah. One of the things you'll read in many places is that early Sanskrit poets used the Fibonacci numbers as a basis for the meter of some of their poems. And that's actually true. He did. There's evidence to suggest, I mean, that we know that. That's in the writings. They did that. I mean, they didn't go far out on the Fibonacci sequence. It was just the first few, but they were using it. Okay. The pattern that you were adding the last two. In other words, add two and get the new one. Add two and get the new one. They were explicitly using that pattern. That is the pattern of the Fibonacci numbers. Add the last two to get the new one. Even if you're doing verse, that's an obvious thing to play with. And they did. Okay. Another one you'll read about, and this was interesting last night, because at this point I realized that sitting right down there, there was the founder of Renaissance Technologies who knew a lot more about this stuff than I did. And he kept quiet at that point, which was nice for me. You will find many websites. In fact, if you type in the phrase Fibonacci trading, you'll come across a bunch of websites, and here's one, that will claim that if you make your selections according to the Fibonacci sequence, that you will get a better than average returns. Now, this is an interesting example. It's interesting in several ways, but the question is it mathematically significant? Is there a mathematical reason why using that would give you the answer? So is it true or false that when you sort of look for the golden, you look for Fibonacci sequence in the way the market's going up and down, that you can then use that to generate a prediction? I'm just going to say it's bogus. No, I am definitely not convinced. However, does that mean that traders cannot get better than average returns or better than other returns by doing? Not necessarily. It could do. First of all, if enough traders believe this, that's already imposed some structure on the market. Well, that's pretty good. If you know how all the other traders are going to go, that gives you an edge. Also, and I've talked to some traders, I actually got a... I went on NPR or I wrote a book or something. I wrote something, and one of the traders, with his Fibonacci traders, actually sent me an email and said, how do you explain the fact that I get better returns than lots of my other colleagues by doing this? And so I said, do you actually generate the next Fibonacci number and use that as your price? He said, no, that's just evidence that we take into account in making our decision. Oh, so you're a very good person at judging the stock market, and that's one of the pieces of information. Well, okay, I believe that. Smart traders do good things, and if using they may well make clever use of the Fibonacci. I'm fine on that. But that's not mathematics. That's just been really smart and using evidence in different ways. So I'm not saying false or truth. That's not really the case. And in any case, it's not about truth or false. It's about, are you ahead of the curve? There's just nothing that you can imagine that would give you anything more than just wishful thinking. But it doesn't mean to say it's not a useful tool. Okay. Numbers. You'll see lots and lots of references, not just for the golden ratio, but for the Fibonacci numbers in nature. In the following form, it says if you go out and count the petals on a flower, the number of petals will almost always, not always, but more often than not, a lot more often than not, will be a Fibonacci number. If you count the spirals in the seeds, if you look at the seed head of a flower, you'll see spirals. If you can't see the spirals in the one on the top right, if you squint a bit, you'll see spirals. Most people can, some people can't. And if you count the number of spirals, you'll find that the number is a Fibonacci number. Actually, two Fibonaccis, one counterclockwise and one of clockwise frequency. If you look at a pineapple or a pine cone, you will also find that the spirals and the number of spirals is a... And we're going to pick our pine cones up in a minute. The number of spirals is a Fibonacci number. You will also read that if you look at the way the petals are arranged around the stem of a plant, that there are in terms that the Fibonacci number is embodied in the way the petals are arranged and the number of petals. And I'll describe exactly how that's specified in a minute. And it turns out they're all true. The Fibonacci numbers are everywhere in nature. Remember that name, that person I mentioned a moment ago, Brother Alfred Brousseau, the professor at St. Mary's College who founded the Fibonacci Quarterly. He had two passions in life. One, was mathematics. The other was photographing the California wildlife, flowers and plants in California in particular. He had extensive photographs, which are now all wonderfully online. University of California at Berkeley has these digitized online. Brother Alfred Brousseau's pictures of flowers and plants. A mathematician who was photographing flowers and plants, he was fascinated by the golden ratio in them, which is why it was sad that the Nautilus shell was the worst example we could have embedded in his building. But that's life. Okay. These are all true. Okay. The Fibonacci numbers do occur all over the place in nature. In flower petals, here's how they come up. If you count the flower petals on an iris, you find there are three. There are exceptions. These are by far the majority. I mean, nature sort of plays little tricks every now and then. Primroses, buttercups, wild roses, larkspur, columbine all have five petals. Delphiniums have eight. Ragwort, corn marigold, the cinerea have 13. 21, 13, 21. These are Fibonacci numbers. You will find flowers that don't have Fibonacci numbers, but a huge number do, more do than don't, and you get this kind of pattern. So there is clearly something about the natural world that likes the Fibonacci numbers, which means there must be something about natural selection. We've already seen that the golden ratio is to do with fractal growth. Well, now we're suspecting that the related Fibonacci numbers seem to be embedded in natural selection. Because if they're in nature, it's almost certainly, if they're in nature to this degree, they must be reflecting a natural selection preference. So very intriguing now. And we're about to discover some science which was suspected hundreds of years before we did the science. And it was suspected because of this numerical evidence. What about the spirals in flowers like the sunflowers? Okay, and now you'd need to have this in front of you, and you need to start drawing the spirals in order to count them, because you'd lose track. Likewise with all of the other great examples of flowers that Echinacea has the same one, the flowers that have the spirals in the seed heads. And likewise with the pine cones. Pine cones come in two different types. If you have these nice squat flat ones, you can actually put the pine cone on a photocopy machine, photocopy it, get that image, and put the drawings on. It turns out that there are companies from which you can buy boxfuls of pine cones. Okay? I mean, someone's found a way to monetize pine cones. Good luck to them. So you've got a pine cone, and I think you can probably do this in the light that you've got. If you have a pen, it helps. You've got to count them, and we're going to count them by just looking at them and going round once in two different directions. You've got clockwise, you've got spirals going one way and spirals going the other way. If you put a dot with a coloured pen or something on one of them, that'll help you avoid getting lost, and then count how many spirals go around one way, and then count how many spirals go around the other way, and see what numbers you come up with. Okay, I'm now going to do what no self-respecting professor ever should really do, is give you the answer, right? Those are some of the other things, but if you look down at the bottom, pine cones, what you should have found is that there are 8 clockwise and 13 counterclockwise. Now, you may not have got that answer. There are 3 explanations for not getting that answer. One is that you just got lost in the count. 2 is that you actually can't count. And 3... in an audience, in a group this big, there is actually a pretty reasonable chance that one of you will have got a pine cone that doesn't have those numbers. Has anyone got one that doesn't have 8 and 13, where they don't think it's because they can't count, or got it wrong? Are there something's broken off? Although you should still be able to count the spirals, even though there's bits broken off. But you got 5 and 8? Do we believe that? Have you seen some of those? It's just a small, really small one. Is it one of these teeny tiny ones? Oh, there are some tiny ones. Yeah. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Actually, the fact that the smaller ones will give you the different pair might indicate that this is something to do with a growth pattern, the way these things grow. we're beginning to suspect the science now, and we look at this thing and we think, how does this thing grow? And what's, is it growing like the Fibonacci? It's not quite as trivial, because these are, the spirals are sort of an emergent property of the local properties, but we begin to think of how it might grow, that it's, if it's growing one way, if it's got to achieve a certain thing for natural selection, it begins to seem plausible that these are connected. So what seems like a mystery to someone in the 21st century who knows about genetics, natural selection, plant growth, we can start to understand how this is plausible. But this stuff was actually noticed long time before genetics and modern science came along. Okay. Let me give you the other example, and then we'll actually look at the scientific explanation, because by now we should be looking for a real honest-to-goodness scientific explanation. And there is one. Most of it wasn't discovered until the 1990s, and the story I'm going to tell you is still an incomplete story. This is incomplete science. It's science that's still been done. But the people, the botanists and the people, and the people that do the modeling have actually figured out quite a lot of what's going on. Okay, the final example, before I go into the little bit of science, is this one. This is an interesting one. It's a little bit of a setup. If you look at a plant that has sort of stems and then leaves coming out of it, as you go up the stem, you will notice that the leaves are sort of spiraling round. You can trace a spiral staircase as you go up the thing. Okay? So that means you can count things. You can count how many times does it go around before one leaf is on top of another leaf. Eventually, one's going to come pretty close to being, essentially above the other one. Okay. You can also count how many leaves have actually appeared all the times it went round until you get. So the number of times round you can count, and you can count the number of leaves that appear during that cycle. And that's going to give you a pair of numbers. Now we're going to look at the unreduced, this is like blood pressure. You don't divide 120 by 80 or whatever it is, you just leave them like that. A good way to reduce your blood pressure would be to just factor them out. But despite the fact that doctors have to pass a calculus exam to get to medical school, they actually don't know about factoring out fractions. That's okay. So we call this unreduced ratio, P over Q, is called the divergence of the plant. It's a measurement of sort of the degree of twisting and leafiness of the plant. Okay. Guess what's going to happen? The divergences of a plant I suppose I'd better give you a diagram, but you can guess what's coming next, right? You've seen the pattern now. Those are two images of side views and top views of what's going on. You're going round until one's directly above the other one, and you're counting the number of leaves that go round. Okay, so you can think of it from above and the side. That's just to help you visualize the thing. Okay, you get pairs of successive Fibonacci numbers. One and two, not necessarily successive, but pairs of Fibonacci numbers. One and two, one and three, two and five, three and eight, five and eight. Okay. Interesting. Again, we can say, what's going on here? Well, if you're a leaf, what you really want to happen is you want to see the sun. You are really put out, if a leaf is right above you. It's like someone building a big building next to you. It's not done. So if you're a leaf, if you're a plant where you want all the leaves to see the sun, you want to avoid one leaf becoming another. So there's a natural selection advantage to having the leaves not obscure each other. If a leaf does obscure it, you want it to be as far away as possible. So there's a clear optimization to twisting leaves around and doing so in a fashion that minimizes the chance that one's going to get in the way of another one. And we can guess what might be the optimal way of twisting around. Now we're about to do the science. Those observations, including the one about what's known as phyllotaxis, which is the looking at those the divergence properties, they were certainly known to the ancient Greeks, and Da Vinci certainly knew about this. This has been known for a long time. They didn't know about plant growth and genetics and natural selection back then. That's very recent stuff. But they'd observed this. Turned out they didn't have a scientific understanding to explain it, but this was clearly it was so strong an observational fact that there's obviously got to be an explanation. And Kepler also noticed that the Fibonacci numbers just keep coming up and up and up. So this has been known for a long time. In the 19th and 20th centuries, a lot of empirical work was done, a lot of amateur botanists and people started counting things. People began to think about it scientifically. It was clearly not an accident. It's just too much of this to be an accident. And it's not an accident. And then scientists in the 20th century began to piece together a story. And you could argue about whether this was the final step or the beginning of the end of the beginning, whatever. But this was really a big piece of work in 93 that really sort of nailed a lot of this of the story. And in a nutshell, which is also something that grows, and certainly in a pine cone, it is all about maximizing it. Well, it's largely about maximizing sunshine. It turns out that the degree of rotation that's going to maximize minimize the chance of one leaf obscuring another one is either the angle's going to be either the golden ratio or an integer multiple of the golden ratio, or something like that. Okay, so we've got some knowledge of that. In the case of flowers and spirals, it's also to do with the way they grow. And we sort of looked about that with these spirals. We thought, well, these things are going to appear. There's a sort of an additiveness. We sort of began to have an intuition that it was because of the way they grow. And if you look at the way seeds are put, if you're a flower growing a seed head, what you really want in the world is as many seeds as possible packed into that space, given that they're going to grow one at a time. And it turns out the way to do it is a pattern that generates these spirals. There's an emergent property, and that there's a golden ratio factor involved in the way you place them. It's the golden ratio, by the way. These are not the Fibonacci numbers I'm talking about now. The science leads you to the golden ratio. It's the golden ratio we're talking about at the moment. That means we're going to have to answer the question, why the Fibonacci numbers? Okay. So the golden ratio has this optimization for growth, just like it does with fractal growth. Okay. The golden ratio is the number for optimizing stuff when you're growing in a step-by-step fashion like that. So why is the golden ratio the one? Well, this is kind of this is one of those things that you have to relax your mathematical, your pure mathematical intuitions. Because I want to say that to minimize occlusion of these things, what you don't want is common factors. You want to make sure that you're moving around by an irrational number, because that's going to minimize the chance that you've got one a multiple of things over another one. So you want to twist round by an irrational number. In fact, you want to twist round by, if there's such a thing as the irrational number, which is the most irrational number of all, that's the one you want. Now, that's a really weird thing to say, the most irrational number. What do you mean, transcendental? What do you mean? There's lots of answers to that. Well, you mean the answer that makes the most sense in terms of plant growth. And the people who do plant growth say that the thing that makes the most sense is that the continued fraction is this one. That gives you an irrational number that's as far away as being a rational number as possible. There are many answers to that question. It's a very unspecified question. It's a weird question. But you can make an argument that from the point of growth, is the most irrational number there is. It's the one that's really going to keep you away from repeating when you go around. And that, of course, is the golden ratio. So here's the sort of the mathematical explanation. The mathematics is only part of it. But that gives us a sense of why the golden ratio is there. Question: how do the Fibonacci numbers get into it? Well, because nature has whole numbers of petals, it has whole numbers of seeds, it has whole numbers of spirals. We're counting these things. So nature has to truncate and approximate the golden ratio in terms of whole numbers and fractions of whole numbers. But we know that the numbers that approximate the golden ratio mathematically are the Fibonacci numbers. So the Fibonacci numbers come in because they are the natural rational approximants of the golden ratio. And this is sort of bound up with that infinite fraction and so forth. So there's a, you can tell a story. It's not a mathematically rigorous story, but it's a story that makes sense in that context. Okay, so we have an understanding. And now we know why those numbers are in nature. And we also know why the golden ratio is in nature. That is really the end of the talk. So when you think about it, there's all, by the way, there are some people who say that if you understand science and you start asking questions about the world scientifically, it destroys the mystery and the beauty. I could never understand that. There's a great mystery and a beauty. Understanding the mystery and the beauty is even better. You know, knowing that the golden ratio is part of that, that's wonderful. That adds to the knowledge. Knowing why it affects it, that adds to our knowledge. To me, I can't see this view that says trying to understand nature diminishes the mystery. No, it makes it even more miraculous. Not least because that natural world has produced a species that has a brain that is capable of reflecting on itself and its environment and figuring it out and developing mathematics in the process. Is that not wonderful about creation? It's produced creatures that can do that and reflect on it and develop this mathematics and explain it and understand it. The mathematics is beautiful. The golden ratio is the most wonderful number in the world. It doesn't need dressing up with other stuff. It's there in the world around us. It's a beautiful, beautiful number. If you want to know details of everything I've talked about, the book that I was using as my reference is Mario Livio's book, The Golden Ratio. The one thing he gets wrong is the Nautilus shell. Mea culpa. I have a $30 million building as part of my legacy. He has a book as part of his legacy. We've both got to live with that. But we are scientists. We accept that the evidence has forced us to believe that. But it's a great book as a reference. So if you're dubious about anything I've said, take a look at the book. He'll tell you the reference. He'll explain it, and he'll give you the references to the scientific work. There's my book, The Man of Numbers, which just came out. And I'll finish with one interesting story about The Man of Numbers. Because I was going back to Italy for 10 years doing the... I was spinning it out because I like going to Italy. And so for 10 years, I kept going back to Italy. And each year, I would talk to the archivists, I'd talk to the historians, and I'd go in the archives, and I was learning more of this stuff. Because most of the scholars are based in Siena and other Italian universities that study medieval Italian mathematics. And every time I went back, I was struck by something. I would get on a plane, but I would leave my home in Palo Alto, right in the middle of Silicon Valley. I'd close my Macintosh, and I'd get on the plane, and I'd come off, and I'd be cognitively in the 12th, 13th centuries. Everything I encountered could have been said about Silicon Valley in the 1980s. Leonardo, the story of Leonardo was almost to the fine detail repeated by Steve Jobs in the 1980s. Librabacci became the Macintosh computer. Librabacci leading to all kinds of stuff came the way to the Macintosh, the Windows interfaces changed stuff. The parallels between those two numerical revolutions, those two computing revolutions, those two personal computing revolutions, putting computing into the head and putting it into the hands, into the artifacts that we have in our hands, that was so dramatic that I thought, I've got to put this in the book. So I had a chapter at the end of the book that said, this is Steve Jobs in Silicon Valley. And my editor said, take it out. But as one of the legacies of Steve Jobs and Silicon Valley and so forth, and all of that stuff, we now have e-books. So together with my editor, we said we'll bring out a little e-book called Leonardo and Steve. So for $2.99, you can get this cute little book that will draw out the parallels. And the interesting thing to my mind is the parallels are unbelievably uncanny. This is history repeating itself. The first time it was in wetware, the second time it was in hardware, but everything else was the same to the fine details, including the detail of there being a missing manuscript. And I'll leave you wondering what the missing manuscript was in the case of the computer revolution. We're done, folks. Thanks for coming, and I hope it's not raining.